and music fans, of course, welcome back to my channel and welcome to my first ever interview. My today's guest is the head of delegation of Iceland, Felix Bergsson, the man who teaches me a lot about what Eurovision is and what does it really mean to be head of delegation. And we were talking about all of those topics. Of course, we were talking about Dadi Freyr. I would be glad if you subscribe to the channel, if you like the channel, if you share it, if you leave the comment below. But now it's time for welcome to Felix Bergsson. How are you doing, man?
I'm doing great. Doing great. You know, bored, of course, with the COVID situation, but, you know, doing okay.
Okay. So, tell me how this COVID situation actually affects you at Eurovision, because you were favorites after like many years of like kind of unsuccesses, then like two years in a row, you're super on the spot, you know, number ones or really like kind of favorites. Definitely the best PR for probably many reasons. But this year it was looking really, really serious that you probably have a really serious chance to win. And after the Eurovision was cancelled, it kind of looked at the song from Dadi Freyr was just taken like he already won. It's like super like tens of millions of views and listens, and that's quite awesome. So how was it when they cancelled it?
Well, I mean, I think it was disappointing for all of us when it happened. I never take anything for granted in Eurovision. I mean, you never know what's going to happen on the spot. It is a live TV event, and that's really where it all happens. But we were very happy with all the attention that Dadi Freyr got. And it was very interesting to see the song really take off after the time of the competition. And it has now gotten 50 million plays on Spotify, and we have never ever seen anything like that here in Iceland. So the song really became a kind of sensation. So we are very, very pleased for him and very pleased for Icelandic artists in general, because that's really what we want to achieve when we take part in Eurovision, whether we compete or not. For us, it's the success of, and so we are very, very pleased to see him gaining all that success. Of course, it was disappointing that, you know, that we didn't get on the big stage in Rotterdam. But I mean, there were bigger things at stake. So it was really, you know, I feel more for the people who have suffered because of the pandemic rather than us not winning Eurovision. You know, it's just something that kind of comes and goes. And one day Iceland will win Eurovision, and then we will be very happy to greet everybody in Reykjavik.
That would be awesome. I think you're really on the right path. I must say it's actually awesome thing what happened, and that was something we wanted to achieve. I personally wanted to achieve to be in such a spotlight. And this year, for most of countries, people, probably even you, was super crazy and not that positive. But what I must say that the Iceland was definitely on the spotlight or in the spotlight. You had this song, you had great PR, everybody was just talking about things. And then, of course, the movie. Were you somehow involved in it? Or how did it especially, what happened on Iceland? How did it happen?
No, I wasn't really involved in the movie that much, but I wasn't involved at all. But RUV, you know, our broadcaster was involved a little bit. I think we helped them out quite a bit. But it was just so nice to have it all happening at the same time. It was really quite amazing. And the town Húsavík is the talk of the town for many. And if there would be tourists, many tourists would be going especially there because of the connection with the film. And hopefully when COVID is over, people can use the opportunity and go and visit Húsavík. But it was, I mean, it was incredible to see all this happening. And I mean, you know, I wasn't sure about the movie to begin with, but now I really like it. And I, you know, I've been watching again, and it's so silly and so stupid, but it's so funny. And some were trying to be offended by it. You know, people were trying to be offended because they felt that he didn't speak real Iceland, and it was nonsense. I mean, the names are, you know, secret. Yeah. It's not an Icelandic name. It's just a stupid name. But you know, it is funny. And it's all for the humor. And actually, there was a lot of love for Eurovision in that film. And I really like that. I appreciated that. There was love for the competition. Lots of silliness, but lots of love as well.
Actually, what probably most of us expected, I was kind of felt offended when I saw the first trailer. I said, like, I'm the person I really want to see Eurovision, you know, to be taken seriously. And then this, which is, because the thing is that we tried to make it look serious, even for our board in the TV, to make it seriously, to give us like more space in the PR, whatever, just, and their argument was exactly what the trailer shows, you know, and that's like, shit, god damn it, you know, how can I fight it? But then when we saw it, there was so much internal fun things, which probably not even fans knows, or, you know, something what was really hidden behind, and you know it, I saw it, and it's like, okay, this is kind of true, you know,
yeah.
Kind of.
The Russian party, I think we've both been to that kind of parties, you know. But still, I mean, it's quite amazing to see what you've done for the Czech Republic in Eurovision. I'm sure that people in Czech have more belief in Eurovision after seeing what has happened for you in the last 4 or 5 years. I mean, it's a huge change, and your artists are getting more recognition, which is great. And that, I mean, I think that is really what Eurovision should be about.
Yeah, I'm really glad that you're saying it, but back on you, this is not definitely about me, it's about you and the Iceland. And I'm really curious, because I've never probably asked you this question. It's like, you know, fans and people in general, they don't understand the role of the head of delegation. And I really think it's even not that easy to understand it properly, because like in each television, in each country, it means something a bit different, you know.
Yeah.
You're, for example, you're not the internal part of the ROV. You're hired to be head of delegation, aren't you? Which is a bit untypical. So how did it happen?
Well, I mean, it is different from country to country. I mean, I am a freelance guy, but I work quite a lot for RUV, you know, the Icelandic national broadcaster. But for example, I don't really, I'm not so deeply involved, for example, in our pre-selection. I have, you know, I have a little saying in it. I advise on it, on our pre-selection, but I'm not so deeply involved in it. But I take over when the pre-selection has finished. When we have the artist, I take over. I take the artist into my arms. And I start doing the work that is Eurovision. So I think it's a very good. I think it's a very good order of things. We really work. We have special strands, and we can work in that area. We don't have to do everything. In some countries, people are doing everything. I mean, I know head of delegations that are choosing the songs, that are, you know, doing the whole thing, you know, leading up to Eurovision. For a whole year, I don't do that. But the job of, but I take over usually on the 1st of March when the artist has been chosen. And after that, I work very closely with the artist and with the artistic team. For me, it's very much being the captain, keeping everything together, getting all the energy of all the people, putting it in one line and trying to push, you know, to make a very strong river. All the way to the end, but there are so many things that can happen. I mean, it's like the most, it's the most unpredictable job I have ever been ever.
I saw you, and saw especially your delegation. And that was really inspiring for me. And I think for Christoph and the rest of the team, all the time we saw your team, how you stick together, how good energy is around, how you take things easily. Easygoing, kind of, even I know you were taking each part, each year very, very seriously, but with kind of a noble thing around, you know, spreading a good atmosphere around, which I don't know if it's common for Iceland in general, I've never been, or it's something you are doing with your team to, what's the spirit, what's the thing?
No, I, I of course course, I think it has to do with the character of the head of delegation. How you know how you create the atmosphere and how you lead. But I was very lucky. The person I took over from had been head of delegation for something like 20 years. Wow. And he was very organized, and he was very good at his job. So I took over a very good shop. You know, I was very lucky in that sense. But I put my character into it. I prefer people to smile. I prefer people to be happy, and I prefer to project how much we love Eurovision. Really, I mean, we really love Eurovision. Iceland loves Eurovision, and that is very important that we project that attitude. And I always say that to my artist. I mean, you may have your views about everything, but remember that you're presenting the nation, and you're presenting a nation that loves it, and you're in it because we love the competition. And so you have to realize that. And I think that helps people a lot in approaching it, all the silliness, things that are kind of strange from time to time. But, you know, if you approach it with a smile and humility and love, then everything is fine. So, but, you know, all the delegations are so different. Sometimes you have a delegation that likes to party a lot, and then you have to deal with that. Then you have a delegation where nobody drinks alcohol, and you can just, you know, focus on getting to the gym every morning. And then, you know, you just have so many. And then we have a delegation like Hatari in Israel that had a very strong political message that they wanted to portray. But you're trying to please everybody, and it's very, very difficult. So, you know, there are very different scenarios. But we try to approach it with a smile and with, first and foremost, a love for the competition, a love for the event.
A lot of love for music as well, because like if I remember from 2016 to 2020 when I was part of it, even like in 2020 I was just a small part of it after all.
Yeah.
But who guessed it? You never know that. But in 2016 in Stockholm, I very clearly remember that you were taken as kind of favorites as well, especially for this semifinal. Yeah. And then Greta Salome just didn't happen. So how was it? Because like the second part of this question is that I'm really surprised. I really like small islands, small nations, kind of, if I just count numbers.
Yeah.
Has just this good approach towards music in general, and you're always sending something very good, or you're definitely on national selection every year. It's very strong, and it's like two or three really good songs. Not every time it wins, of course. No. You never know that. You can't do anything about it. But there's such a big potential, you know. And in 2019, Hatari, and this 2020, that's just wow, boom! It's awesome.
Yeah.
It's awesome. How this happened? What are you doing differently, or how you're approaching artists to make good songs and send it to Eurovision? How the process works? Do you know about it, or can you share something?
Yeah, I mean, we're just very lucky with we have very good artists that are prepared to take part in, you know, artists that we want to be in the competition to send in songs, and that has worked really well. And this is for example how Dadi Freyr happened this year. He was somebody that we asked to take part. And he did it, and he did so well. So we are doing it in we are not yet doing workshops or the weekends where artists come together and write songs together. But it's very important for us that the songs are Icelandic, that they are that we are working with the Icelandic music industry.
Yeah.
That we are not just taking songs that are sent to us from wherever. We are actually working with a real Icelandic artists that are going to benefit, because we are putting a lot of money into it. The Icelandic music scene is, even though it's doing quite well, it's still, and we really feel our responsibility as a national broadcaster to use that money to support the Icelandic music scene. So we are very stubborn about this. We just take songs that are from Iceland, from Icelandic artists and from Icelandic songwriters.
Like that was something we were trying to establish here as well. We were kind of like a mix. We were trying to tell people, just do it. That's our duty as a public broadcaster people, to support the music industry, especially here when we as our team weren't really happy what's commercial in here. It's definitely had no chance anywhere else. It was super local. And we said, like, but the talent is here everywhere. Just watch Iceland. Watch Iceland. They can do great music internationally. And we are, like, I don't know, 10 times bigger, more, you know. So probably more talent is here as well, somewhere.
Yeah.
And our goal was to dig it out somehow, and that was very inspirational. Yes. when we saw you doing this work, that it was nothing we invented, of course, but we just got inspired, and I really appreciate the thing you're doing, because like bigger countries doesn't do this, which I don't understand why, but I love how you treat Eurovision, because what I think the Eurovision is nothing really special. It should be like the song for Eurovision. I think you should do just great music, and that's it.
Exactly. No, but I mean, there are so many things that come together in Eurovision, though. I mean, Eurovision is not only about it is the song to begin with. Number one is the song. But then the staging is so important, and also the ability of the artist to perform live. I mean, that is so important. You have to have an artist that is capable and able to perform live. And that, for me, is the one of the biggest challenges always when we have these 2 months to prepare for the big show, is to prepare the artist for everything that goes on in Eurovision, but also just for getting on that stage and performing that song perfectly for these 3 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's like making a 3 minute art piece. I mean, you know it yourself. That's what you do. It's making a piece of art in 3 minutes that stands perfectly, so that nobody leaves the television. Everybody watches it from beginning to the end. You know, so it is very important to have that in mind as well. I always think about the things that my friend Mats from Universal said. He said you need to have an artist that can stand on the stage and fill the 5,000 or 10,000 arena right to the back of the, you know, of course it's television, and television is going to do a lot, but the artist, him or herself, they need to be able to fill the arena, and because that will be projected on the TV screen. And I think that's the most important thing. So there are so many things to look into, and it's lovely, but I am very proud of the Icelandic art scene. I mean, it is very vibrant and very lively, and we have managed to grab that into Eurovision. I mean, to get an act like Hatari into Eurovision, I think it's quite amazing. I mean, it's great. And it says a lot about, it says a lot about the respect that Icelandic artists seem to have for Eurovision at the end of the day. Everybody here loves it somehow.
Yeah, I'm thinking that's extremely fantastic. But the other thing, what you're doing, especially like with Hatari, which were quite like Rammstein style kind of, you know, if I just compare it somehow to get more understandable, and you just show that there can be quality music like this at Eurovision, that it doesn't really matter. There's nothing like special Eurovision genre, even there probably is, but it's not necessary to be there, you know, it's not something.
Yeah, exactly.
And I think that's that because like what we were saying as well is there's 200 million people watching it, and 200 million people deserve to hear you whatever you are doing. It doesn't really matter if it's Eurovision or not. There are 41 or 42 countries each year, and it's up to them what they're sent. That's
mm-hmm.
that's the Eurovision, not the Eurovision itself. So each country is doing this puzzle. And I'm glad to have you here. It's like I always wanted to ask you how are you doing this, how it's possible that like I remember in 2000 it was 17 18 with the Ari, I'm not sure right now, it was
18
and in Portugal, and it just wasn't successful. I don't know if if you felt that, or you were, if you were, you know, having this, like, it can change, the odds can change, we can do better, you never know. But probably you somehow know that, of course. I don't know, but how was it for you? Because it was 3 times in a row that you didn't go through. So what was on your mind after?
Well, I mean, yeah, we knew. I think we knew pretty well that the song would not qualify. I mean, we tried our best. We changed the act. We did lots of things to try to. But for me, when it's a year like that, for me, it's most important to promote the artist and to get the artist into the limelight. And I think Ari himself got a lot out of it. He was excellent and an excellent artist. And I was very pleased with that group, and I was very pleased with him, and I was very pleased with Thorun, the songwriter. She's a great lady and a great visionary. But, you know, at this time, it just didn't work somehow. It just didn't work. It never got the attention of anybody, really. But Ari did as an artist. And he has a lovely and beautiful career in front of him. So when this happens, you just try to focus on the artist. Of course, you focus on the song and you try to do it as well as you can. But somehow you know that it's not gonna go very far. And that's the only way to do it. And I was very proud of him. I was very proud of them, all of them. And I loved that group. And it was really nice to be with them in Portugal. I mean, it was a really nice trip. But you know, that's how it goes. Sometimes you're you know, sometimes you hit something, sometimes you don't, and that's basically how it is. We started looking into, after these 3 years of not qualifying. Even though I was very proud of the songs that were there, it was Greta Salome, it was Svala in Ukraine, and it was Ari in Portugal. We started looking more into the song process and how we chose the songs, and that's when we started approaching certain writers about sending in songs. And I think right away the quality of the songwriting went up a little bit. So I was very, very pleased with that.
And you even think that this approach change, it helped as well as those authors and artists, musicians, whoever you approached in the process, they felt that there's the quality rise is needed, or even they felt like we wanted to feel or make Iceland proud, or let's do it differently, let's do it better.
Yeah, I think so. And I mean, I think it is, you know, everybody just tries to do their best always. And I mean, but it has to do with the fact also that we have had this selection process now for maybe 12 years, something like that. We have this selection process where people send in songs, we go through them, we choose, and then, you know, and then, you know, we choose 10 or 12 songs, and then we go through as the years go by, you start getting the same songs again and again. Yeah, it's like, so they, you know, people don't give up. They sent the song again. And suddenly you had 200 songs, and 50 of them you heard before. You know, these are songs. So suddenly you realize that there is not so much renew. It's not renewing itself so quickly. And then it started happening that songs had been sent in a few times before. Suddenly they were in the competition. And then you think, oh, it was not good enough 2 years ago. Why is it good enough now? You know, so it's kind of, we really needed to shake this process a little bit. And that's really what we have done. And I'm very pleased with that, with the result. And we also cut 2 songs out. Now we only have 10 songs. We used to have 12 before.
So it's like a bigger competition to get in. So
exactly. And also we have a little bit more money to spend on each song. A little bit more money to spend on the staging, a little bit more money to spend on the recording and all that stuff. So I think we started getting the results right away from this working method.
I'm really curious because, like, I'm not sure if it's true, but you were the one who approached Hatari and asked them to take part, weren't you?
No, it wasn't me, no. Right. I think it was completely their own idea. And they had, of course, they had an agenda. They hated the idea that Eurovision was being held in Israel. They hated the idea that Iceland would send an artist to Israel. So they said to themselves, why don't we go and make problems? So I think that's what they decided. But, you know, there's a great new documentary out about their trip to Israel.
Yeah, I haven't seen it, but I was definitely about to ask you about it because you were sharing some thoughts on Facebook before already. And we all know that being in Israel for you wasn't the best, probably the best experience. Because probably so many reasons, of course. Hatari, maybe your political approach, whatever. It probably was a really, really like fire saga ground for you, kind of. Not an easy thing. Can you share something with me about it? Because like, I just maybe have political differently opinion, but I'm always curious about how you directly felt there.
Well, I mean, in my autobiography, but no, it was tough. Of course, it was tough. And what was really tough was to have an artist that was working with me on Eurovision, but at the same time was working on a different project with a documentary team. Mm-hmm. So there was a constant pull between me and the documentary team. So I was always trying to get them to do Eurovision things, and they were always trying to do things in Palestine or whatever they were doing. So it was constant, you know, it was a constant pull and a constant struggle in that sense. And also because I believe that Eurovision should be a non-political event. We can argue endlessly about if it is a political event or not. But I really believe in the original idea that the people of Europe should get a week once a year where politics are put aside and we just sing together and enjoy, you know, being together. And I still believe that ideal since the Second World War is a very important one. And that people that are singing together are not fighting each other at the same time. I mean, we have huge, I mean, can you imagine how it is for Armenia and Azerbaijan to compete in Eurovision now, or for Ukraine and Russia? I mean, there are so many things going on. But somehow people manage to put these things aside and just concentrate on enjoying the competition. And enjoying the songs and the pop music, so that's what I believe in, and I try to put my own political views aside in this. I try not to air my own political views in this because I really believe it should be non-political. I am a very political person, and people hear me in Iceland talking. I talk about politics. I talk about human rights. I talk about lots of things here. But when it comes to Eurovision, I want to put these things aside and just concentrate on the competition. And that's what I was trying to do, of course, in Israel. But the artist had different ideas. and you try to work around it. I mean, as much as you can. But I mean, nobody will be happy. I mean, Yunola will, you know, and the Eurovision will not be happy. Hatari will not be happy. And maybe I'm not so happy either. So it's kind of it was a certain kind of struggle. It was great fun at the same time. I really regard them very highly as artists. So that was, you know, there was no question about that.
Yeah.
And I was very proud of the act on stage. It was it's a brilliant act.
That was great. I loved the way how it was done. I really loved the song, but I really was, all right, this is something kind of new, something, you know, pushed limit or showing the creativity, what can be really done live. I think not every person, I really struggling even here in Czech Republic, they don't understand how much time and creativity you need to put into doing 3 minutes because you're doing the music video live, and that's something very, very different. You need to plan every millisecond of it.
Totally.
And it should work.
I liked so much the The contemporary choreography was brilliant, and there was so much, you know, in the movement and in the actual. Yeah, it was just a beautiful performance. I loved it. Absolutely loved it. So I'm very proud of it.
Yeah, you should be. I was really proud about how it was all done. What I wasn't that proud of course, was that what you were talking before, is that just the bringing in politics into it. I must really admit, I must say, I was kind of really pissed off when they just waved the flag. But maybe it was some kind of part of my ego as well, that I don't agree with this politically, but it's just my problem. But the second thing is that I was always trying to say it's not political, but always there's some, well, whatever idiot who just throws some flag or do whatever, because it's something they want to do, which I understand. Like, I just, back in time and nowadays, I understand it. It's not that easy to separate just such a big thing and having it without politics. I think we both understand, we want it like that, but you can't do anything. It's like it's far beyond probably. But it was something which was just like, why, you know, like I have to say every time it's not true, but I have no proof of it, but I really believe what you said, that the atmosphere anytime at Eurovision, and when I went there for the first time, I couldn't imagine how such a big thing can have such a great atmosphere around.
Yeah.
It's really uncommon. It's even like smaller projects in like local countries in Europe, they have their problems, they have their tensions, but here is something very different, and I'm really, really glad that I was a part of it, because like that's what, how you smile right now, you know, that's it, that's come in here and learn. We will teach you, we will show you. What you take out of it, that's up to you, but enjoy, you know, enjoy and feel the feeling, and that's awesome. I'm really curious what you're gonna do next year. So can you tell me something about the plans for next year? What you can share with me?
No, I can't share anything with you, because there have been no decisions and nothing has been announced yet. I mean, it's still a question: are we gonna have a pre-selection, or are we gonna go with the same artist again? And that's the big question that is being asked these days, but I have no news on that yet. But hopefully we will be able to come out with it in the next 2 or 3 weeks.
Okay.
But COVID changed everything. We, like everybody else, are fighting for money at the moment. There's huge cuts at RUV at the moment. So we are really making decisions what to do. And even though Eurovision is the biggest event, and the pre-selection is one of the biggest events that we take part in every year, so they're still counting the money. Yeah. So unfortunately, I can't tell you anything, not at this moment. No.
Okay. You can tell me is how COVID situation affected your life, not just personally, but even professionally, because like you're an actor. You're a radio speaker and host, so how all of it combined changed your life?
Yes, completely. I mean, I perform a lot live. I perform a lot for children and for families and stuff like that. That is all gone. My theater work, I do some theater work. I'm an actor as well. That is all gone. So a lot is gone. But I keep my job as a head of delegation, and I keep my radio show every week. So I'm one of the lucky ones. I have a job, after all.
Yeah.
So I have something to do. But it professionally, it has taken a lot from me economically. But I'm okay. And I will survive. And it's it's not a huge problem for me. But a lot has gone. And it's a great shame. But I've been very lucky in my private life this year, because I've had my first two grandchildren this summer. My son had a child in June, and my daughter had a child in July. So now I have two grandchildren, and that has made the year the best year ever. So there are definitely pros and cons.
All right. And you have a time for them to visit probably a lot.
Exactly. And now that people try to avoid too much contact, you know, we, the family, can keep together. So we see the children a lot, and nobody else sees
my first impression was, and I was writing it to you like, I don't know, 2 months ago or a month ago, that I thought that you adopted a kid because like you were always there with your boyfriend or husband, and
yes.
And I was like, okay, I love this progressive country, that everything's possible there, it's great. And then I know my grandfather's like, shit, I didn't thought that you that what. And I was a little bit shocked, but I saw how happy you are, and yeah, as you said, it's something pro. It has pros, it has cons, and those pros are great, awesome. Probably, did you have time? The other question is still about the COVID. I'm really curious because like we're now probably having this a big second wave in here in Czech Republic, and the government really doesn't do their work properly. Definitely a lot of lies spread and bad decisions. But what's the wrong about it that you don't know what's going to happen next day? You just don't know. And of course, our professions, as we are TV professionals and both of us freelancers, you never know what's going to happen. But this is really super new, special experience as the job's just falling down like from a day to day. We are probably both of us lucky, but how the government in Iceland just threat freelancers on this industry, entertainment, because like it's not just a big complex chain of jobs involved. So what's your governments do?
Well, they are trying. I think they are doing their best, and I think. I mean, we are also having the second wave, and it's really huge at the moment in Iceland. So we are really fighting it. There's a semi lockdown in Reykjavik. Or people are asked to stay at home as much as possible. There's no theater. There's no concerts now, and there's no audience at the football games. In fact, they have stopped all sport for the next 10 days. So we are really going through that. But for the freelance people, I mean, the government is trying to come to support companies, to support small restaurants, to support the bars, and to support also people who are freelance. I mean, they are seriously, and they are also trying to support freelance artists. So they are doing quite a bit, I think. And but it will be interesting to see how it all goes. I mean, the main problem is that we have unemployment in Iceland that we never had before, something like 10%. And in Iceland, we never have unemployment. There's always work in Iceland. So that's a huge problem as well. But the government is doing something differently from the financial crash. During the financial crash, they tried to get us out of it through austerity by cutting down everything. But now they are doing it totally differently. Now they are flooding money into the system constantly. I mean, they are really trying to keep the system going, putting the government into debt, but trying to keep the system going rather than the people having to take loans and going into debt. So they are doing quite well. And I think there is trust. There is trust in Icelandic society to the government and what the government is doing. And they have listened. They listen to the scientists. Every day we hear from the scientists, not from the government.
Mm-hmm.
And that is very important. And we have really great people there at the forefront. People from the national security and people from the medical profession. And they speak to us every day. They explain to us why they are doing certain things. 80% believes in these kind of measures. Of course, there's lots of people saying, you know, they're taking away our freedom. We should just let the virus go and we should just, you know, get herd immunity or whatever it's called, you know. And then you have Mr. Trump screaming in the background all the time.
How do you think the situation can affect the creativity, the artist, the art, the passion for music? I not created, but I just released the first video of my YouTube channel. It's called New Possible, which mostly means just don't look back or just don't say something is normal. It's like the situation is so extraordinary, different than anything else before we experience it, that maybe everything can be like a new possibility, how to approach, to find new approaches, even in music and TV, and how to help things out, how to work, how to survive, and how to create something. And do you believe this situation can actually help somehow even the industry itself lockdown people just be more creative, or do you think it's more like depression's coming out? What's your idea about it?
I have no idea, to be quite honest. I mean, I think creativity will always find a way. You know, creativity will always, you know, because we are, that's how we are made. We are creative, a creative being. And I think creativity will always find a way to get things out there somehow. And there are, I mean, for example, I think there's a lot of, there's a lot more, podcasts and stuff like that going on now. Artists are taking to the internet and doing concerts on the internet and also on TV here in Iceland. All the TV stations are now having kind of live events with artists, with musicians, and people who are taking part in Eurovision, you know, and they are on our TV screens every Friday and Saturday and Sunday night now.
So your public broadcaster really, or not just the public broadcast, probably even the commercial ones. Do they really support the industry this way?
Yes, they are doing that. They are doing that. And I mean, the people are supporting it by watching it and supporting it. I mean, people love it and people like it and people want it. But, you know, the problem is always the money. I mean, where do you find the money? And I mean, how do you pay the wages? And how do you, I mean, and we have had, a, I mean, our economy is really going, you know, and on a
each economy, yeah,
on a downturn. And I mean, we have had so many tourists coming into the country in recent years, and suddenly there are no tourists. I mean, we had 2 million last year, and now we have nothing. You know, it's like, so it's a huge shock to the economy. So, and it will take years to get better again. But I think, I mean, I think we are so good at adapting. And I think when this blows over, whenever that happens, we will very much get back to where we were before and just continue regardless.
Is that kind of like an Icelandic nature to go forward, to never giving up, you know, like, okay, the situation is like this, but you know, it was worse, so we just go forward.
No, I don't think it's an Icelandic nature. I think it's a human nature. I mean, I think it's like because I'm always talking about the small children, the babies now. I mean, women have babies, and it's a very for many of them quite a traumatic experience. But then, you know, 3 years later they have another child. It's like, you know, you just continue somehow. You just go on with it. And in Iceland, we have very harsh nature, and also we have a very volatile economic life in general. We always have crash every 10 years, so we are just used to. We just have to just continue. We just have to look up, be positive, and continue. We have a saying in Icelandic, which says basically everything will be okay. You know, everything will be okay.
Cool. That's cool.
And that's it, you know, and then you don't have to worry about, you know, anything more.
Yeah, I think that's a great ending for our interview, that everything's gonna be okay. That's what I really pray, that for you, for me, and for everybody else, and for the listeners, but for everybody else, to be the way out of it.
And we will enjoy a great Eurovision in May. It will happen. People don't need to worry about that. It will happen. Europe will come together and sing together and do their competition together. And I think it will be a huge event in Rotterdam this year. Maybe not so many people in the audience, but it will definitely be on our TV screens, and it will be great. Fantastic.
Yeah. You promise?
I promise.
Okay, cool. I love it. Man, thank you very much. It was Felix Bergsson from Iceland Delegation. I really appreciate he was here with me, with you, and sharing his thoughts with us. So many thanks again, and see you soon, man.
Take care, Jan. Thank you.
So guys, I hope you did enjoy this interview. I had a lot of fun doing it. I was super glad that Felix got a time for me. And I hope to see you soon on the next interview and next videos. Please leave the comment below, or find me on Twitter or Instagram or Facebook, and tell me what you think. See you soon.